This is another segment of Historic Fairfax City's oral history. And today I'm honored to interview James Wyckoff Jr. My name is Hildy Carney, I'm a board member. And we're taping at a very interesting historic site that is very special to Jim. The Fairfax Station Railroad Museum in Fairfax Station. We're going to be talking a lot about that later. But first, I want to talk to Jim about his experiences growing up in this Fairfax area. Jim has always been active in our community, and rightly so, since his family background of service in the community is not a surprise. Jim, can you start back in 1600 when your ancestors came here? And briefly, tell us a little bit about how you came to be here in the area.
Thank you, Hildy. Peter Clayson Wyckoff was a friend of Peter Stuyvesant's in what is now known as Brooklyn, at that time as New Amsterdam. And as friends do for friends, Peter Stuyvesant allowed my grandfather to become the first magistrate and the first brewery master, quite an interesting combination there, for New Amsterdam. And from their friendship, they both bought some ground, they both had they raised their families, and the Wyckoff family, who had come from Holland with we ended up with about 11 children. And each time a child was born, they would add another little section on this little farmhouse that they lived in. Over the years, it was owned by various segments of the family. A number of years ago, probably 30 years ago, the City of New York Parks and Recreation, through a grant from the U.S. Department of Interior, took over management and actually bought the house from the Wyckoff Foundation and Association. It is the number one historic landmark in both the city and state of New York. It is basically a clapboard farmhouse still used as a museum, and every third grade student from each of the five boroughs of New York come there to see what early farm life was, or early life, if you will, in New York City. There's still an active working farm in the heart of Brooklyn there. Through the years, my family, as I understand, were basically farmers, and they migrated from New York down to Pennsylvania, ultimately to Loudoun County, and then to Fairfax. Their farm in Fairfax was part of what is now Burke Lake. My great-grandfather was a member of the Board of Supervisors, was chairman actually at the turn of the century in 1900. His father was one of the first school trustees before there were school boards for Fairfax County. Over the years, my grandfather, sold the farm. My grandmother was, and my grandfather were married in Burke, Virginia. My grandmother worked for the Treasury Department. My grandfather was a clerk at the store that subsequently my father bought. My grandfather died at 32. My father was 35. But they had been very active in the community in their short lives. My father bought a store in Burke at 16 years of age, and subsequently bought a store here in Fairfax Station at the age of 19. His store in Fairfax Station became a very important part of the community. Feed was one of the things it sold. It was a general store, but it sold everything. And with having several stores at once and also having a business relationship with the Southern States dealership where the Whole Foods is now in Vienna with Dr. Miller, they took a lot of time. A number of the members of the community were employees, but more than employees, they were really friends of my dad's. And they will all, you know, they and their descendants will always say, you know, say that and feel that. For instance, we had a warehouse down by the rail station, and when the feed cars would come in with 30 tons of feed, this was primarily, all of Northern Virginia was primarily a farming community, a dairy farming, if you will. And so we would deliver those with the various trucks and community members and all. And I remember vividly one day I was with a Mr. Collier, a wonderful man, and being very young, and I was sitting on the back of one of the trucks with the feed bags. By the way, if I may divert for a minute, many times the women in the family made the decision on what kind of, you know, feed to get, not based on the quality of the feed, but based on the material from which they would make their dresses and shirts for the, you know, for the husbands and the children and all. But anyway, I was on this truck, and we were coming across, doing probably 4 or 5 miles an hour, coming across this little rise by the sidetrack, actually right there at the track, and the bag came down. It's a 100-pound bag of feed with Mr. Collier and I sitting on it, and everybody panicked, as you would think, but we were fine. And so for as long as Mr. Collier lived, he used to love to tell that story, and it was a wonderful story. It just showed you the spirit of this community. The first television was at the Collier's house, and you know, we would be allotted a certain time that we could go to, you know, watch television, all the kids in the area. And then, you know, you go home to dinner or whatever. The adults may come back to that house later to watch television. With my dad dying at such a young age, the community was just amazing in the way they accepted my sister and I. And to the extent that we were, even though younger, with a lot of the folks, we were included in all the activities of the older, you know, folks, and it worked out very well for us. I think we ended up with a very a compassion and understanding for how people get along and that sort of thing. But growing up in Fairfax Station was a very interesting experience in that it was truly a community in every sense of the word. It didn't matter what your religious affiliation was, and with St. Mary's Church here, a very important part of the community, the entire community, was that there still is an annual Labor Day picnic, and the entire community would participate in that. And people just really, really got along. There were a lot of funny stories, some that can be told, some that cannot. One of which was, we had a local gentleman who was a contractor and really, really a wonderful guy. And he had an old 30-something Chevrolet. And it was a real, he always would ask people to ride with him. But in those days, believe it or not, we would hitchhike every now and then to Fairfax, the town of Fairfax, now the city of Fairfax, which was the hub of the central area of Fairfax County. And so on this one occasion, my friend Colby Collier and I, who Colby's mom and my mom had come to the county as teachers, and Colby and I became very good friends. And in any event, we were hitchhiking, which I'm sure our parents would not have liked to have known, but we were hitchhiking to Fairfax, and this gentleman, Mr. Cruzy, stopped and said, "Would you boys like a ride?" And the answer, you know, was kind of difficult because we really didn't want to, but we thought we'd better since he'd asked us. And so we got in his car, and it was a 30-something Chevrolet. And unfortunately, he never let the clutch out all the way, which you know, the engine was just completely roaring. We were doing about 5 miles an hour. We were going up 123, and a large crowd. In those days, it was hard to get a large crowd of cars because there weren't that many people around. This large crowd of cars had formed behind us, and they were just blowing the horn and uttering all kinds of words and everything. And finally, this guy gets by, and he, I don't know what it's appropriate for this, but he shoots a certain sign to Mr. Cruzy, and Colby and I in the back said, "Oh my gosh." And Mr. Cruzy looks around and says, "Yep, boys," says, "everybody knows me." You know. And so there's so many of those type stories, but it was just a brief idea on what happened in this area. Mr. Cruzy built the house that we actually lived in. And his wife, they were childless, and his wife adopted all the kids in the area, and we would go there at least once a day while he was hard at work, and she would bake cookies for us. I mean, there's so many of these wonderful memories of down here.
Well, Jim, talk a little bit about your mom now.
My mom was known as the little engine that could and do it. What happened was she had always had a love for the railroad. She was a teacher, and not designated as such, but she was when she was hired, she and Mrs. Collier were basically the county's first two special ed teachers. They were assigned classrooms with people of all ages in them, and that's the way it was. My mom taught at Centerville Elementary, Clifton Elementary was our first, Fairview Elementary, and actually at Fairfax Elementary. She maintained that love of the railroad, and over the years, a lot of my dad's shipments would come in that way. My dad was also the postmaster, but in those days, he never did any of the postal work. It was one of the clerks there that worked in the store that did that sort of thing. So when he died, she didn't work for a number of years until he died. And when he died, she had the option of going back to teaching school or becoming the postmaster. She became the postmaster, and it was a wonderful thing because it was right next to our house. She was able to do all sorts of other things there and all. And so when she retired, the Southern Railway made an announcement that they were going to close the last standing railroad station in Fairfax County, the last station on the main line in Fairfax County. And she just said, "This can't happen." And she still recognized as the founder of this building that we are in. And her involvement was, and with the wonderful help of the Clifton Community Women's Club, of which she was a member, and they were able to save the station, take it down board by board from its where it was and move it up here. But to do that, she and the chairman of the board at that time, Mr. Harity, had to go to the president of Southern and see if they could get it donated. They did, but with one stipulation, that it be moved from that site. She then went to the Freed and Moore families who owned the ground here, some 5+ acres, and got them to donate the ground for it. There were a number of people very involved, mostly the community at that time. Then the Fairfax County Board of Supervisors donated $100,000 the same year. They donated $100,000 to the Wolf Trap Foundation to help to redo the station, because after several years of trying to put the boards back up, some deteriorated in various things. And then the Fairfax County Vocational Education Foundation stepped in and put two classroom trailers on the site. The Associated Builders and Contractors were also involved. And before you knew it, this station had life again. And some of those students are still members of the Fairfax State, members of Fairfax Station Railroad Museum. My mom's love was for the people. She was a very, very involved member of the community. When the Burke Airport was coming, which it never did, as you know, became Dulles instead, but we would have a lot of meetings in our yard. My involvement with the community became, I was there as a kid, my sister and I just kind of hanging around and listening and all. And over the years, then I thought, you know, I would do this also. But
Jim,
yes.
I'd like you to tell the story about the P.O. Box number one.
P.O. Box number one has been in our family for years and years and years. And, you know, we still have it. And many years ago, there was a gentleman who was running for Congress at that time who wanted that box. And he actually called me and offered me a great sum of money to give him that box. He was a person also who believed in privacy and this sort of thing. And I you know, good-heartedly would say to him, hey, I will not use his name, but sir, I thought you were the guy that really, you know, cared about privacy. And this, first, how'd you find out it was my box? And secondly, I can't believe you're asking money for it, you know, or whatever. And so that's all.
I think that's an interesting story.
Yeah.
And the fact that you still have P.O. Box number one in your family.
Right.
You've talked a little bit about your memories of your father's store and Fairfax Station. I know you went to grade school, high school, and prep school here. And can you talk a little bit more about the area then and how it's changed?
I went to elementary school here in Fairfax Station at Fairview. And it was a very active, there was a very active community. We actually had a softball team that would go to play other elementary schools in Falls Church and Arlington and et cetera. It was a member of the patrols, and 4-H clubs were very big in those days. So the kids would get to go from the area if they were involved, and most were in either of those organizations, would then get to go to camps in Jamestown during the summers. And those were great memories. And then there was no middle school in that time, and you went from the 7th grade in elementary school to the 8th grade in high school. I then was able to see the world and go to Fairfax High School in the 8th grade. I played football in the 8th grade and met an awful lot of friends. And so the next year, they were at Annandale or McLean or whatever. That was during the time in the 50s when Fairfax County was proud of building a class. They would advertise, we're building a classroom a day, and they basically were. Through those friendships, I would know a lot of people, and people during that time really got along well, and it was not anything unusual to be in Annandale, McLean, even into D.C. on the same night at various parties or just seeing your friends and that sort of thing. Fairfax City was kind of the hub, and I met one of my best friends, a number of good friends, from going to church in the city on Sundays. And what would happen is many of the guys that would their parents would drop them off at the Sunday school, and then they would, you know, goodbye to the parents, and then run down to the local Chamblin's Market, which was on University Drive in the little building there. Bellissimo's at the front of that building. And, you know, we'd just meet and have a soda or whatever, and then go back in time that our parents could pick us up or whatever. But it is amazing the number of people that actually met and had lifelong friendships through through that. And we'd certainly go back then to, because in those days you had to go to church also. You'd go not only to Sunday school, but you'd go to church. So you really didn't miss out on it, right, on a lot.
I'd like you to talk about one big historical event that happened on the railroad.
There were President Roosevelt's death was just shocked the world and the community. And there was a train that carried his body, as you know, throughout the country. And in those days, it was really significant if you could get near a rail and put some sort of a coin, normally a penny, and they would flatten out as it came over. I don't ever know what happened to mine. I'm sure Lee Hubbard has one, but that was kind of a historical thing. But the actual community would go there. It was an event. They would come to watch, you know, watch the body and the train go through.
Right.
So.
Right. I know that you also did a lot of things, very industrious things, when you were a kid. Like, tell us about the Washington Post and what you did there.
That was an interesting thing. Fairfax Station was a very small community, obviously, very, very rural, and your route couldn't get too big. But I had a good route, and the distributor said, asked if I would like to sell some papers. And I said, sure. So he would take me into communities, and I'd go in there and sell these subscriptions to the Washington Post, even to the extent that I had a business card, and the theme was, don't miss Walter Winchell in the Post. And it had the rates, and, you know, had my name and my telephone number, which was at that time 94J2, as you can well imagine, you know. Very successful doing that. So somehow one of my new customers called Bill Gold, who was a columnist for the Washington Post, and they wrote a little article on me on being a very enterprising young
guy.
How
old were you then?
Probably nine, 10 at most, yeah, something like that.
So you were making some money at 9 and
yeah,
10.
Yeah, I made a little money, and then I spent it.
Right. Okay. Well, Jim, I know then that you moved to the Fairfax City while you were just in your early 20s.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about why you came to the city and what you did.
Come back from college, and I had actually run our store for about a year, and I was more of a caretaker because it was pretty much on its final legs at that time, the one remaining store here, and I went 1 year to the Old Bailey's Elementary School. It was called the Northern Virginia branch of the University of Virginia, which is now George Mason University. And it was great because you could take 15 hours by going 9 hours one day and 6 hours the other. And so Monday and Tuesday you'd be through. And you had great professors. Like I had Jules David, who was internationally known as a foreign affairs specialist in those days at Georgetown. And many of the professors from the other main colleges in the area would kind of moonlight there. And so it was great. But also, people got me involved. I guess I got involved a little bit in the community. And there was a referendum for the Redevelopment and Housing Authority, which was a very controversial thing at that time. And it passed, and this is in Fairfax County, passed by not a lot of votes. And I was named to the first Fairfax County Redevelopment and Housing Authority. And I was also somehow elected as vice chairman of the thing. And it was such, you know, we are interviewing face to face today. We would meet in the old courthouse, and there were five members, but it was so hotly contested that people would actually bring tape recorders up around us, and, you know, to make sure that quote unquote, we did the right thing, whatever that may have mm-hmm. may have been. Well, while acting as the, while being the vice chairman, the chairman on a business trip to Sweden died. And there I am, a 23 or 4 year old kid, as chairman of the of one of the most controversial, you know, at that time, authorities in the county. It worked out fine. In the meantime, I got married a few years after that and decided to move to an apartment in Fairfax City. I moved into the Fairfax Square apartments, which are still there. It's an amazing story in that they are still a great place to live. After arriving in the city, I became active in a number of things, whatever would pop up. While in the city, I served as chairman of the Board of Architectural Review for 19 and a half years. All of these things were busman's holidays because I was working for the county at that time. I was also on the city school board for a while, and have been involved in the Downtown Fairfax Coalition, which I am now simply chairman emeritus. But it was very interested and still is interested in revitalizing, reinventing, whatever, doing something with the downtown. And that is an ongoing situation. I have never had a business there, but have been involved because I really think that the more good business we have in the city, the lower our taxes are, and the better quality of life we can all, as residents of the city, enjoy. Right. So,
well, how do you think that your parents were a big part of what you chose to do in your career?
I think that they had a significant influence on me, although I didn't realize it at that time. Candidly, I had somewhat of a chip on my shoulder and did not want anybody to tell me what to do if they did. Unlike, you know, kids today, the same way, I'm sure. But I always thought I could do most anything. And if someone would suggest something, I would think not. But it goes. But when I think of it, it goes back to my mom and dad both. I mean, my dad at 16 owning a store.
Right.
Come on, you know. And my mom doing the things she did. She was already in her 70s when she chose to make the station a reality. And so I guess I got some of the spirit from them, and influenced my life. Greatly. I believe in community involvement. I think that it is, you know, it's just so important. And in down financial times are good financial times, but particularly in the down financial times, the volunteers do so much for this community that, we wouldn't, a lot of folks wouldn't be able to survive
right.
without it.
So. Talk a little bit about how the city has changed, both in the structures. I know that you've watched the downtown change drastically, and from some of the businesses that are there, the growth, the politics, things like that.
Mm. When I was in high school in the city, there were four diners, for instance, that were active on Lee Highway, Fairfax Boulevard, as we know it today. The restaurant business alone has changed greatly over the years. We have almost 200 restaurants in Fairfax City now. And what basically has happened is the city lost a lot of the businesses that were downtown when the county moved its headquarters out to the government center. As the executive director of the Fairfax County Planning Commission at that time, you can imagine I had very mixed feelings about that. The Also, with the road configuration, with 66 and a number of things, people would move into, businesses would move into shopping centers rather than downtown. A successful downtown needs a good mix of, you know, of businesses. When I grew up and attended school in Fairfax, and as a young person growing up, we went to downtown Fairfax for almost everything. There was a drugstore, a soda shop. I mean, you name it, it was there. Your dentist, your doctor, all of those things. Your attorney. And, you know, now most of the attorneys are at Tyson's. That's a big change itself. There have been a lot of very good decisions and a lot of decisions that weren't as good over the years with the downtown. That is a very, that is something the city is working very diligently now to make it, let's just say, make it more successful than it currently is. I think it can be a success. There are a number of things that need to occur. The city's changing politically because the demographics of the city are changing greatly. And one of the, I think it's interesting that the city is considering going to four-year terms, which will allow a bigger voice, I believe, in the community, because now it's two-year term in an off, you know, general election time, and it is very difficult. Once a person runs, they've got to start running again, mm-hmm. you know. And so, but the Fairfax City has such excellent services that I've raised five kids, my wife and I, in Fairfax City. And it is, you know, I would love for them to live in the city. And there'll come a time as they get older. That's another thing that's happened in the city. We're getting, you know, grayer as a community. And that is something we have to really take a good hard look at and see how are we going to accommodate that, both in terms of housing, you know, in terms of financially, in any number of ways. So,
did you have any special hangouts back then when you were growing up or later in Fairfax that you can tell us about?
That I can tell you about. Yeah, that's well put. Yes, there were several. One of which was Tops, T-O-P-S, Drive-In, and it was a drive-in restaurant that was also in Arlington. And so, if you were really lucky, in one night, you could drive around innumerable times the one in Fairfax, and then fill your car up and go to Arlington and drive around that one to be known and all. And there was also the Marriott also had a restaurant called the Hot Shops, and at all of these places they had car hops, and it was very very interesting, very open. Anybody could go, you know, with accommodations. Anybody could go anywhere, and you would see a number of things happen that you would say, "Did this really happen?" or whatever. But occasionally, you would actually, if you were lucky, you get there early at night, you could back your car in, always back it in, and watch the folks go around the innumerable times. And yeah, that was one of the things. But the Persian restaurant was Simpson's Diner. The Vincent's Diner, again, was where Denny's is. 29 Diner, which is recently reopened, was where it was. That was built in 1947. That's the year my dad died. And then there was Bob's Streamliner. Now, one of the things I didn't want to say is I kicked the sign out there one night. I was a kicker. I learned to kick as a kid sometimes by myself behind our store. And there were a couple of the garage places had boards that went up like this. And so I learned to kick from the furthest place I could. And it always assured me of a job on any team that I played on. But I also used to like to show off. And so I was very different, I must tell you. And, you know, with a chip and kind of being cocky. You know, it didn't serve me well sometimes. But anyway, so I used to, you know, people would dare me to kick the ball over the Streamliner Diner, later to become Bob's Beef House, sign. And I was successful most of the time until one time, 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, the whole thing, obviously we'd been with some friends in DC. And I kicked it and it didn't go far enough and the sign is in shambles. Oh. And I subsequently admitted it. You know, I always found out that was the best thing, man. Admit it right away. You know, I did. And we, you know, I paid Bob Parcells for that sign. And every time he would look at me after that, he would grin, you know. And when I was in high school, there was an event that got some national publicity. There was an old coach restaurant that was across from the old Fairfax High School. And one morning, it somehow turned up. It had been in front of the restaurant. It turned up on top of the restaurant. You know, I don't know how that happened. Actually, I did. But what had happened is the night before, a number of very enterprising young folk were able to disassemble and reassemble that old coach on the top of the old coach restaurant. And that was, there were some other things that happened that were really, really incredible. There were, in the town of Fairfax, they had a small police force. And I had a car that I bought in Fairfax, it was bought for me rather by my mom in Fairfax City at the old Logan Chevrolet. Soon after that became Jim McKay Chevrolet, and it was located again right at University in Maine across from Old Town Hall. And anyway, that car was very interesting because it gave you an outlet to the community, to everything. And, you know, drove it to school, drove it around after and all. But there were also other types of motorcycles were very big. And if I could divert back to when my growing up here in Fairfax Station, my dad had a very good friend during World War II named Joe Starry. He owned a garage. He also owned an Indian motorcycle. My dad, because of quote unquote essential business, could not go in the service. So he was the air warden for the area. And when they would have the air raid warnings and all, he would have to go around on the back of his friend Joe Starry's motorcycle and make sure all those green shades were pulled down and all. But anyway, the reason I mentioned the motorcycle is, and I hope this is not too convoluted, but I was playing football at Fairfax and I got cut. I still have the scar here, obviously, by the an aluminum cleat. And so it had to be sewed up. And so they took me to Dr. Fagan's, who was downtown Fairfax City on Main Street. Still there, it was a night game. And what happened was, it was on the back of a motorcycle. A guy named Paul Sinclair, who was a wonderful, wonderful guy, was a Fairfax County policeman. He had been a great football player at Fairfax. He had later come back to become kind of a quasi-trainer or whatever. And he rode me up there. I got, you know, Dr. Fagan said, would you like Novocaine? I didn't know what it was, stupidly, and said no, which, by the way, I've always had since. And he sewed it up, came back on that motorcycle, and actually got in for a couple more plays in that game. I'll never forget that. That was quite an unusual, you know, occurrence, as I realized later on. But there were so many things that were related to the automobile in those days. I was actually a member of a group called the Road Knights, which was an Arlington-based, sponsored by the Arlington Police. A guy named Bill Jeanette, who was like an officer friendly, would do it, and we would do supposed good deeds. If you saw somebody on the side of the road, you would have to stop to, you know, to help them in any way you could, change a tire or whatever. We were always in the annual parade that used to be held on Constitution Avenue for the AAA and the schoolboy patrols. When you were younger, you marched as a schoolboy patrol. When you were older, if you're lucky enough and you have a car that you knew were a member of the Road Knights, you got to be in that particular parade or whatever. So.
Well, Jim, I know that you still have a lot of friends in the city that you grew up with, mm-hmm. and still hang out with them a little bit and talk about mm-hmm. the history. Anything else that you would like to share with us about the city's history or any of the things that you and your friends did? And talk a little bit about your career. You're so modest, but we need to hear about what you did in your career.
Well, I have a great allegiance to Fairfax High School. Because, and we actually, you know, there was an honor code, believe it or not, and you really believed in it, and you really followed it. And what was interesting was that we actually wore coat and tie for a couple of days during the 5-day school week. And so subsequently, I was very young when I graduated from high school and too young to go in the service or, thank goodness I didn't go to college that young. But I went to prep school for a year and played football up there at Randolph-Macon Academy in Front Royal. And then I went to college in a number of places, the most notable of which to me was the East Tennessee, a small school down in Johnson City, Tennessee. And I also did some, I took a few courses at the Harvard Graduate School of Design, and was a real estate broker and consultant and vice president of a company called Lynch Brothers, which was the largest commercial real estate firm in this area. And I did things like, I did research stuff like cost-benefit analysis and for what is now the Fair Oaks Mall. That was one of our clients, the Taubman Companies, and also for what is now known as Springfield Town Center, but it was the Springfield Mall, the Arlen properties. And from that, I was always interested in local government. And so I was asked to apply for the job of executive director of the Fairfax County Planning Commission. And the first time I was asked, I didn't apply. I was not that interested. I was very active in so many other activities. I was president of the Fairfax JCs, and I'm a U.S. senator and also an ambassador in the JCs, which is the highest honor you can have. So I spent a lot of time with that, but that was a community-based organization. So the second time, about a year after that, I was asked to apply. I did. And it came at a time when I really needed a change. And when I applied, there were 150 or 60 applications. And I got down to the last two, and I got the job. And I had every intention of staying there no more than 5 years. However, I liked it, and it was really interesting in that we had 1 year where I had to be at all the Board of Supervisors and all of the Planning Commission meetings, and that was when there were eight of us involved with a group called PLUS, the Planned Land Use System, and we got all sorts of national recognition and all, but it wreaked havoc on both our home lives, our physical beings and all, because we met, believe it or not, over 300 times in 1 year, in 1974. I was fortunate enough to win the, I don't know how I did it, but the AHEATH OMTHINK Award, which is the highest award for county employees. Subsequent to that, I stayed with the county for 30 years, and as I mentioned earlier, you know, did a lot of busman's, you know, holiday stuff with the city. And Also became active, I won the Dennis Duffy Award from the Fairfax County Bar Association, which is an award for civic involvement. And Dennis Duffy, the reason I mention that is, Dennis Duffy was a longtime resident of Fairfax City who was chairman of the City Planning Commission and an attorney and a stock car driver. And he was quite, his wife was known as Duffy the Clown. She is still around. She performed at all sorts of events in the city. And his involvement in the community had been so much that it meant an awful lot to me to be able to win that award. But I got involved with the Bar Association then, and I'm still a current member of, I've been for 25, 30 years, a member of the board of directors of the Fairfax Law Foundation. And so I've had a career, I've done all sorts of things. I work part-time now for one of my daughters. I'm a vice president of her company. It's a very successful leadership training company. But she and my wife got together and said, you know, I'm gonna give you a title. I said, no titles. And we negotiated salary down. And now the vice president of TNT, this and that. And it's the greatest job a retired person could ever have, you know. But I'm still involved in the community in every way I can.
And yes, so. I know that, even though you are retired.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Jim, for sharing these wonderful memories with us. This has been very fascinating to hear about your life and the area around Fairfax Station. Thank you. This has been a historic Fairfax City oral presentation. We were very fortunate to be able to film this at the Fairfax Station Railroad Museum, and we encourage you to come and visit and learn more about its history.